Chapter 4. Personalities on the Olmalog Farms, 1952. Piet Huger was recognized as one of the top Battle of Britain pilots. He was seconded from the South African Air Force, and at the beginning of the Second World War was in Britain studying aircraft engineering. He then moved into the Royal Air Force and did his flying training. He was shot down twice and was probably one of the most decorated pilots of that time. Piet was a quiet, gentlemanly person, as strong as a horse, but as gentle as a lamb. As an indication of the sort of person he was, a distant relation of his made a girl pregnant. When the time for the birth came, Piet made all the arrangements for the birth, and it was immediately assumed that he was the father. To avoid embarrassing his relatives, he did not deny the rumour. He was prepared to accept the responsibility. Piet arrived on his farm about a month after the allocations had taken place, and he remained there alone developing the farm for some time before his wife Angela and daughter Mitzi arrived. Next, on Unit 2, was Pat Wyndham Wright. He and his wife had both worked with the underground in Holland for part of the war, during which time he had won the Military Cross and lost an arm. He employed a fellow who was known as Tinkelbell. Unfortunately, neither of them were farmers. They spent much of their time away from the farm, and when they were on the farm, they didn't appear to be doing very much. They didn't build a proper house, living in an aluminium mobile hut on a concrete plinth together with their dogs. The hut was an office, living room, bedroom, all combined. First impressions on going into the hut were not very pleasant. Pat was a very kind person, but rather antisocial, and his friends always seemed to come from somewhere else, never from the Olmalog area or nearby. There was one memorable occasion when he had a big party and everybody got extremely drunk. One group of three people went off after midnight, got stuck in thick bush, and made their way back through the bush on foot to the only light they could see, which turned out to be where they had started from. Next morning they couldn't find their car. Pat turned out his labour force, and eventually Robin Johnson's plane took off and found the car about 400 yards from the house where they had had the party. Pat had an interest in the Meerschaum mine down towards Amboseli, and in order to communicate with his people there, they had a code whereby they would flash lights to him at night, and they replied the same way. Tinkelbell, his manager, was coming out of Arusha one night, very drunk, in an open Land Rover with no driver's door. He hit a bump, fell out, and the Land Rover carried on until it hit a pile of stones and stalled. He landed on his backside on the tarmac road and carried on with the momentum, scraping his backside rather badly. He was rushed to hospital in another car, which was passing, and discharged after 5 days, still unable to sit down properly, so he had to be driven home, which gave the locals a good laugh. On another occasion, Pat sent a message asking if I could come and see him as he was not very well. I found him in bed wearing his tackies. His feet were so swollen he could not get the shoes off, and he was running a very high temperature. My wife Pat, who is a nurse, had brought him to our house, where he was immediately put to bed, the tackies cut away, then he was treated, and spent days in our guest room until his temperature and swelling went down. Then he just left without leaving any message. About a week later the same thing happened, but this time my wife had sent him to hospital. My farm was next, followed by Derek Bryson's. Derek came from Kitale in western Kenya. During the war, he had been training as a pilot in South Africa and had an accident in his Tiger Moth. This damaged his spine and left him with a permanent limp. Often when the weather was bad, he had to use a stick. Later, he had another accident, this time in his car, which did even more damage to his back. But none of this stopped Derek from working at any time. He was extremely tough and could stand pain much better than the majority of us. When the Mau Mau problem started, he and some others volunteered to go and help in Kenya, and he was appointed a co-coordinator of military activities there. His wife Bobby, who was related to the Leakeys, also had a bad limp at times, as she had suffered from polio in her youth. But this did not stop her running the farm on her own when Derek was in Kenya helping out with the Mau Mau intelligence. They had a large Mercedes 6 saloon with no clearance and no other vehicle to run the farm. At the time, even Land Rovers were finding it difficult or impossible, but somehow she managed. On the other side of the Brysons were Dick Soames and his wife Jill. They were on unit number 5. I believe Dick was a distant relative of the Churchill family, and I feel this could have influenced the board when allocating the farms. It was one of the best farms in the area, and he did not have as good qualifications as some of those who were turned down. Dick was by far the youngest of all the 8 farmers. His wife Jill was very pretty and had a really nice disposition. After a couple of years, Jill and Dick parted, and the farm was sold to Michael Wood, the famous flying doctor. Next along the line came Robin Johnson, who was, I believe, in partnership with Sir Archibald McIndoe, the plastic surgeon who had done so much wonderful work at East Grinstead for RAF pilots and other badly injured servicemen. He was also responsible for starting the East African Flying Doctor Service, in combination with Michael Wood and Tom Rees, who were, I believe, understudying him at the time. Robin had been a DC at the start of the groundnut scheme at Kongwa, which was where I first got to know him properly, although I had also met him before the war, when he was at Tukuyu in Tanganyika. We became good friends, as we both had connections with the groundnut scheme. Robin had also been one of the Battle of Britain aces, and had been very highly decorated. It was at East Grinstead that he met Sir Archibald McIndoe. Both were bachelors at the time, although Archie had in the past been married, and I believe had a daughter in England. Unit number 7 was awarded to Brian Freeburg with his wife Joan and 5 children, the last 2 being twins. Brian had served with the South African forces in Abyssinia, the Western Desert and Italy, where he was taken prisoner of war. He escaped and lived on his wits for some considerable time in enemy territory, until the Allied forces pushed forward, allowing Brian and another fellow to rejoin the campaign. His wife Joan was the sister of John Millard, who later purchased Unit Number 8. At this particular time, he was DC of Moshi, and had in fact taken part at the Utilisation Board meeting when the farms were allocated. The last farm, Unit Number 8, which was very attractive but a bit difficult and required a lot of capital for development, went to Con Benson of the Cigarette Benson and Hedges and his wife. They were in fact the only absentee landlords among the group, but they used to come out quite often and spend time on the farm. Delightful people, both of them. Derek Dunn was employed as their manager and started the development. Chapter 5, Markets, 1953. The senior veterinary officer, Hugh Newlands, and his wife Pat had been asking me for some time if they could come on one of my rounds of the markets. As my next round was a fairly large one and went all the way to Loliondo, I suggested that they accompany me until we reached as far as they could spare the time. Our first market was held in Ngorongoro Crater. The evening we arrived there, I decided to go for a walk by the old lodge. Along the road looking down into the crater, I walked about 2 miles, then turned back. As I did, I saw a leopard which started to follow me just off the road. It kept up with me all the way until I turned into the lodge. All this time, the leopard showed no sign of being in any way perturbed, and it kept to within 20 yards of me all the way. In the beginning, I was very worried, but after a while, I wondered if maybe it had been somebody's pet. I made a number of inquiries about people who may have had a pet leopard in the area, but no one ever owned up or had any knowledge of anyone who did. It never happened to me again, and to the best of my knowledge, it did not follow anyone else. The next 3 nights were spent at Endulen, and here again I had a close encounter with a leopard. This time it took a leg off mutton, which was hanging from the fly of my tent, as I had no kitchen tent with me at that time, and I thought it might be about to rain. I had told my staff to tie it above the table in the fly. I awoke during the night, saw a leopard, went for my gun, and the leopard disappeared, with the mutton. Next night the leopard came back, but I was waiting up for it, and there was no mutton. I did not shoot it, as I felt it was doing no harm, but I could easily have done so, as it was no more than 5 yards from me. Young Fedor Ehrlich had come on this safari and was very excited about the leopard. A very amusing incident happened here. Pat Newlands was standing behind my pickup with a whole group of Maasai ladies round her. She appeared to be rather disturbed and waved to me to come over. When I got there, she said the women were getting very familiar with her. I asked them what they were about, and they asked if Pat was a man or a woman, because she wore trousers like a man, but had things sticking out at the top like breasts. Up to that time, European women seldom wore trousers. I told the Maasai they should find out for themselves. So immediately one of them went for Pat's bosom to check, which made her very embarrassed. Eventually I had to ask them to stop, as she was definitely a woman. We then proceeded to have a long discussion about women wearing trousers, and I asked the Maasai women why they didn't wear trousers. They said it was much easier to pee if they didn't have to take everything off, just lift up their skirts and pee away. They said most European women wear skirts, like us. I then explained that European women wear knickers underneath their skirts because they don't like to expose their private parts. The Maasai couldn't understand this and asked, "Why, what's wrong with that?" Whilst we were having this lengthy conversation, I noticed that one of the Maasai Siangikis had a lower set of teeth which came through the skin of her chin rather than growing up through her gums into the mouth. When I asked about this, she said she had been bewitched as a small child. This fascinated me, and I asked doctors on several occasions what could be the cause, and they said it was either inbreeding or syphilis in her parents. As the Maasai are very, very strict about incest, it was probably syphilis. After Endulen, we all went back to the crater, where the Newlands went back to Arusha, and I continued to Loliondo, where my next market was due the following day, taking Fido Ehrlich, the son of my mother's friend, with me. This was in February or March, and on the way I saw more wildebeest on the plains than ever before. It was damp in places, and there were odd pools on the road. All the way from the crater itself, as you started going down to Loliondo, was one continuous mass of wildebeest, all on the move. I have heard since that the wildebeest population in the Serengeti is increasing, but I do not believe this. I have been visiting the Serengeti more than 30 times during the migration in the last 60 years, and on this particular occasion there were more than twice as many as I have ever seen since. In all fairness to today's experts, I did not go to Western Serengeti. This was all on the eastern side, but it went as far as the eye could see into the plains on the old Loliondo Road, and I can't remember there being a single section that did not have wildebeest on it. When we came to the next section, there was a lot of black cotton soil. It was a bit muddy, and we had quite a lot of trouble getting through. Eventually, at about midnight, young Ehrlich turned to me and said, "Can we possibly have some food? I'm dying of starvation." "Well, I'm afraid I'm very bad in that respect. When I'm going somewhere, I don't normally stop for food," so Ehrlich was quite justified in asking. We had a quick sandwich and some tea, and off we went again. We reached Loliondo just at daylight, around 5 in the morning. Ehrlich went to bed and stayed there all day. A long time afterwards, I was talking about my markets, and a young man asked if he could accompany me. I said, "With great pleasure, any time you like." Young Ehrlich's mother, Greta, immediately said, "Don't think of going with David unless you take food with you, otherwise you won't get fed." This was not true. He would not get food whilst we were on the move, but would certainly get good food and plenty of it every morning and evening, as my cook, Sakta, was one of the very best safari cooks. The Loliondo market was a great success, so much so that I was running out of cash fast. But I had anticipated this and had asked Pat and Hugh Newlands to contact Tanganyika Packers, asking them to send more money or cable the district commissioner at Loliondo, informing him that I could draw a certain amount of cash from him. I did not get a reply whilst I was there, so in order to chivvy things up, I sent a cable to Arusha. However, instead of addressing it to Tampak, I deliberately addressed it to Tampaks. This obviously annoyed them, but did have the desired effect, as the cash was sent for me to pick up at Ngorongoro Crater, enabling me to continue with the market at Olalla. We were now into the start of the long rains in certain areas, and a lot of the rivers were in flood. Animals were still weak from eating the green grass and had to be herded very slowly and carefully. When the animals had been living on very dry grass for some time, and suddenly start feeding on fresh green grass, they can run into trouble with runny tummies and take a long time to recover and often die. Those that did survive did reasonably well and put on weight. As this was my own private business, I could not afford to lose too many animals. I accompanied most of the herds in certain areas. When we reached Tequatchujinja, the culverts were down and the area was full of black cotton soil that had already accounted for 8 lorries. Whilst I was there, Gordon Wilson, an anthropologist studying the Barabeg people at Katesh, appeared in his car. There was a lorry completely stuck in one of the culverts, which meant that nothing could get through. It was late, so I decided to camp and the Wilsons joined me, as they had no safari facilities of their own. My cattle had arrived and then had to cross these culverts, so we did what we normally do. By getting a couple of head and pushing them into the water with a man swimming in front, they started to cross. We then persuaded the rest of the herd to follow. So eventually they all swam across the river, although sometimes a few got washed as much as 100 yards downstream before they came ashore. This procedure seemed to impress all the bystanders, including Gordon, who thought it was a great achievement, as we did not lose a single animal. The total crossing that particular time was well over 750 head. Next morning, we got 3 ropes onto the lorry that was stuck in the mud, and about 50 people slowly pulled it up the bank on the other side. After that, we were able to cross fairly carefully. Up to this point, we had lost only 8 animals out of nearly 800. This was really very good, as we now had cattle that were, generally speaking, quite fit and accustomed to the conditions and improving. We still had a good 70 miles to the Arusha abattoir, so I slowed the herd, giving them only a 10-mile march each day. The idea was to put on weight, and it was very successful. In fact, it turned out to be one of my most successful moves at this time of year, with good grass and slow moving. We did, however, have a lot of trouble with the Maasai, and although they didn't get away with any cattle, they were continuously raiding us. At one stage, I had to go to Arusha and pick up more drovers as reinforcements. These were men who had already delivered their own batches. We had 8 guns with the cattle, and I'm afraid some of the Maasai ended up with pepper back and front sides. Lions were also quite a nuisance, but again, my drovers did very well, and at the end of the drive, everyone received a big bonus, including myself, and we were all happy. After this last round of markets, I had been very successful. In fact, my finances had improved beyond all recognition. I had made well over £1,000 with Tanganyika Packers, Arusha Chini, and others. My wife was due back from England the following day, and after picking her up, I went to Arusha Chini to check on the last batch of cattle arriving there, and also to investigate the possibility of buying one of the old Klee Track tractors, a rather large tractor of about 90 horsepower. This was not suitable for sugar work in the wet, but had previously been working with sisal on dry ground. I had been unable to get together a Caterpillar or an International, although my name had been down for some considerable time, so I clinched the deal for the Klee tractor, and I could not continue with the Fordson alone. The Fordson had done me very well, but kept getting punctures and was not very suitable on stumpy ground, as it was only 2-wheel drive. I tried everything from using double tires at the rear, chains, steel wheels, and with very much the same results. It was, however, a very good tractor to do road work, light harrowing and planting. I took Pat Townsend, the international agent in Arusha, and a very good engineer to Arusha, Chini, with me, and it was his suggestion that I should buy the Klee tractor for breaking ground and heavy work. He also agreed to check the tractor and put it in as good order as possible with the available spares. Up to now, all the clearing I had done was by hand, and this was very slow and tiresome. Young Colin turned out to be very keen on his bed and difficult to rouse in the mornings. After he had been stung in his armpit by a Nairobi eye, he asked for my permission to go to Arusha for treatment, although he had a very little infection. He was sent off and told to come straight back after treatment, and he did not return for 5 days. On his return, he bought some plywood, but as he had not tied it down, it all blew off the vehicle, and he did not even realise it had gone. On arrival back at the farm, he seemed quite upset to be told by me that he was not sufficiently interested in work to make any sort of progress. All the 8 farms at Olmalog had now been occupied, either permanently or partially. I had acquired some special pyrethrum seed from a friend of mine in Kenya, so immediately put this in the nursery. The only other person in the area growing pyrethrum was George Carr, who had started a nursery with a different strain. This crop was apparently doing well in Kenya and on Mount Meru in Arusha, but required a lot of hand labour. The rains were soon due, and I had 6 acres of land near my camp, which was completely prepared for planting, so I planted it to maize, as I had no machine, and this was the first crop grown amongst these particular farms. Those 6 acres gave me enough maize for my labour force for the following year, and all I had to buy were beans and oil. Chris Lewis now arrived to replace Colin, who had been completely useless. Chris proved to be a great help, as well as being an extremely nice person. As I was spending time at the markets, and also on hunting safaris, it was essential that I had someone on the farm I could trust. The markets were going down a bit due to the rains, and the sales had reduced, but I still had to have attendance at all the markets. I had to buy a vehicle solely for market work, and I had a very good man who could do the day-to-day buying for me. This allowed me to get on with the organisation of my 3 basic jobs. As Pat was coming to stay on the farm from time to time, one of the first things I had to do was to build a house. The banda, which was made of sisal poles and thatch, consisting of 3 rooms, an outside kitchen, and a long drop, was completely inadequate, especially as our daughter was very small at the time. A proper house was started about 500 yards away. This would later become my mother's home. It was built on wooden stilts from the local forests, and the timber was sawn from our own wood. I employed 6 sawmen and dropped large trees for pillars, olive, podo, and another, which is known as Meru oak. The new house was built on a fairly steep slope. The front stilts were 8 feet long, whilst the back ones were just 1 foot. The floors were of 1-inch boarding and the walls of soft board inside with planks on the outside. As I was doing quite well at the time, I could afford to put in steel windows and could purchase ready-made doors and frames. I did this to make the building work easier and faster. The roof was of thatch, and for 15 years it never showed any sign of leakage. When my mother moved in, I decided that the thatch was a fire hazard, and I replaced it with corrugated iron sheets. The house consisted of a sitting dining room with a very nice burnt brick fireplace, a corridor with a bathroom at the end, and on the right of this a small room, which was our daughter's. Next to the sitting room was a double guest room and the master bedroom at the far end. The kitchen, pantry and toilet were outside, built of concrete and corrugated iron, and connected to the house by a covered walkway. Later, I built a log cabin in the Canadian style, similar to those at Ngorongoro, for Chris with 2 rooms and an outside toilet. Whilst the building was going on, Pat, Penny and I were all living in the old house, which was very inadequate, and any guests had to sleep in the living room. At one time, the district officer from Monduli was staying with us, and Penny, now almost 4 years old, was peeping in on him. He got upset and kept saying, "Stop looking at me." Penny would run away and then creep back for another peep. We were amused by this and were laughing so much that we couldn't stop Penny. This particular DO was not one of the brightest of individuals. He had volunteered that day to shoot a mad dog as the owner wanted to get rid of it. However, I found that he didn't even know how to release the safety catch on the gun, so I did the job myself. The clea track I had bought from the sugar plantation was doing very well. It was difficult to turn as the braking system was very old, but it did a good job of clearing. However, as the tractor was now getting old, it had reached the stage when it either had to have new tracks or just the pins turned once again and then wait for the next thing to go wrong. So I decided on a complete overhaul on the farm, if this was both possible and economically viable. So I consulted Pat Townsend, who said he could do it in 5 days, if everything was ready and available on the farm before starting. On my side, I had to get the tractor in position, using a large forked tree and a branch capable of lifting at least 3 tons, dead weight, to a workable height. At the time, we had no workshops and everything had to be done out in the open. We made our own block and tackle from a large tree and a bar to lift the engine from the mainframe of the tractor. Pat had just finished a complete overhaul of the engine and I was completing the tightening of all bolts and nuts, when suddenly we saw a fire in the distance, shortly followed by a lot of shouting. We rushed over to find Derek Bryson's house in flames, and they had nowhere to spend the night. We had no room in our house, but luckily Robin Johnson arrived, and as his new house had just been completed with room to spare, Derek and his family went there. At about this time, there was a clearance sale at Irambo, the groundnut scheme near Tabora. An Asian friend who lived in Tabora was going to the sale, and I asked him to buy certain items for me. Although he could not get all I needed, he did get two 606 John Deere ploughs, a lathe, and a large mounted electric welding plant with its own engine, the largest mobile plant in the whole of the northern province of Tanganyika at that time. The whole lot cost me £180 plus £30 railage to Arusha. Unfortunately, one plough had disappeared. Supposedly, it had fallen off the train when the carriage was derailed and could not be found. A likely story, as a six-disc plough is rather large just to vanish. However, the one remaining turned out to be worth more than the cost of the two put together. The welding plant was in great demand. Pat Townsend had first call on it, as it was the only machine capable of handling thicker metal. I let it out on hire, and it brought in about 10 times its price on hire fees. It also helped Pat a lot, as he was the only person allowed to operate it, so whenever it was needed, he got the job.